Hello and welcome to the Engineer Innovation Podcast. With me today is Ian McGann, who is a Director of Innovation as part of the Simcenter team. When we started this podcast, the topics that we really wanted to focus on were digital twins, machine learning, artificial intelligence, and also cloud computing. And today we're going to be talking to Ian about something which lies at the crossroads of all those topics, which is massive engineering data analytics. Hello, Ian.
Hi. Thanks for having me. Good to see you, Stephen.
It's good to see you too, Ian, as well. So let's start off by talking about this word massive, because as engineers, yeah, we've been involved in the big data game before it was fashionable. You know, I've been in engineering for 30 years and I still have a filing cabinet full of engineering analysis files stored on DVDs, on magnetic tape. So what does massive mean? Because that's quite an emotive word in the context of massive data engineering analytics.
Well, to maybe go back to the point that you were making, you have a lot of data that you were storing and keeping on tapes and stuff like that. What did you use the data for?
So the intent was really, of course, it was always a backup. So we'd do a simulation, we'd exploit it for what it was worth, and then we'd finish using it. We'd never exploit it. Well, we'd exploit it as much as we could in the time available, and then we'd put it on a tape so that if we were ever, for QA purposes, if we had to get called back to verify our results, or if the project came alive again and we had to do further iterations, we'd always have that information available. Although, you know, 95% of the time we never did, and they just sat gathering dust in a filing cabinet until we don't have the tape machines that we can recover the data for anymore. So,
So you brought up a couple of words. Information is one, and I'll come back to those later on when it comes to massive engineering data analytics. But one of the things you said, okay, you create a model and you exploit it. So you used that model at that time to make decisions, to act and to decide to do something. And I think that's, for me, when it comes to big data engineering or massive engineering data analytics, there's maybe subtle differences, but it's collecting your data, storing your data, analyzing your data with the goal. And I think this is important. The goal is to turn larger quantities or large amounts of data into decisions. But you were making decisions on a single point that you had. You said, okay, we did a simulation and we used it and then we stored it away. And then the next time a problem came along, you had a new model and you did a new simulation and you made decisions based on that simulation, right? And you, as the engineer, because you probably did the previous analysis, you were building up in your mind the knowledge of the previous generations and you could make decisions based on that. So your experience was a big part of it. And massive engineering data analytics tries to capture all of the data, all the previous variations that you have, to help you make an even better decision. Because I'm sure there's things you forget. There's lots of things I forget when I'm working. So it's all about turning large quantities of data into decisions. And it involves collecting, storing, and analyzing that data to do so.
And so when we're talking about this, where is that data coming from principally? Is it coming from simulation models or experiments or field tests? Or
All of the above. So consistency is nice and key for a lot of these things. So when you're collecting data, we take modal as an example, right? Nastron Solver 103. So we're collecting data. We're solving Nastron Solver 103 for the last 20 years on models. And we've learned that the eigenfrequencies of the structure, we know roughly where they are and where they lie. And it's never a big surprise, let's say, when we go out and we do the measurement, we're pretty spot on, right? So the data there, in that case, if I did the simulation and I was very familiar with the structure, I would trust the simulation. I would say, yeah, it's good. I've done this hundreds of times. I know what I'm getting. It's the result is good. And I can rely on that data. In the case where I can't rely on it, where it's a new kind of structure, I've never simulated it before, it's got some nonlinear components in there, maybe I want to rely on the test data, the actual physical data that after the prototype is available. So the source of the data really depends on your level of comfort and the accuracy level to the data as well. But then there are areas where you can't measure. You can't put cameras, or you can't put flow meter. You can't measure inside a vat of molten steel. Right? It just melts. So those areas, you need the simulation data. You have to have the simulation data. That's the only thing you've got. So in some cases, you have to have simulation. And in other cases, it's really depending on where the best result is coming from and where you would trust it. And in a lot of cases, I would trust the simulation for modal testing. Perfect, right? Stress strain testing. It's great. Simulation gives you more information than you could get on the test. There's maybe, you know, on the test, you have to have strain gauges. But then there's also the combination. We'll come to that. That's like the digital twin aspect of it.
Ian, are we talking post-processed engineering data? Are we talking simulation files and and simulation results? What sort of data format? How are we feeding the algorithms behind this?
Usually, in some cases, the algorithms, depending on what you want to get out of it. So if you want to get the eigenfrequencies as a result out of the machine learning or out of the data. So we've gone a step already too far. So let's say we have large quantities of data and we want to turn those into decisions. And to help us make those decisions, we can sort, query, filter on the data, but we can also feed that data into machine learning algorithms. And those machine learning algorithms predict for us results that we might not have measured before, right? And that's the other part to it. So in those cases, when we're using machine learning, the type of results we want would be the same type we would get out of it. I want to know the eigenfrequencies. I want to know the stress and the strain. I want to know the flow rates. I want to know where the hotspots are, right? So the results we want as an output are the same results that we will use from our large amounts of data to feed into those machine learning. And, you know, if you followed any of the machine learning discussions related to ADAS and autonomous vehicles, there it's all about labeling the data. It's all about annotating and labeling the data. So I have an image and I say, that's a person and that's a car, and I label everything. In the world of, outside of this, in stress and strain, in the world of acoustics, and the labeling of the data means, well, that's a booming noise, or that's a modulation, or that's a certain stress at a certain value, right? So the labeling is a little different, but it's still, here's a time series data, and I'm labeling that time series data as being, there's a tone-to-noise ratio. And how did I get that? Well, I processed the data. And that's also an important thing is, when I think of analytics, data analytics, let's say, there's stages to it, right? You have, in your world, you would do a simulation, so you gain information, and then maybe you process that in some way, and you gain some insight. And then you could also do some optimization with it, right? So you can say, well, I want to put variations on the design and then do some optimization. So information to insight to optimization. In analytics, we would call that descriptive or diagnostic analytics. That would be like your information and insight, and then predictive and prescriptive analytics as you go over towards the optimization side. So, you know, getting data is nice, but as you sort and filter and process that data, you start to work toward the insight and the optimization levels. Okay. Am I making sense?
Yeah, no, absolutely. How much work is involved in getting that data into the correct kind of labeled format, or in a format that the algorithms can understand and we can feed to the machine learning algorithms?
Yeah, most of the algorithms, that's a good one. Most of the algorithms today I've seen are taking as an input a CSV file, right?
Okay.
So, and then there are images you'll see as well as algorithms. So if I have an image, I can feed that into the model, but a lot of the time, the algorithms that I've seen are working with CSV files. So a scalar values, point values that you're basically inputting, which means I have to at a certain point translate that data and transform that data to the point where the algorithm will take it. And that's a big part of massive engineering data analytics. When you look at the whole world of data science, 80% of the work is transforming your data, wrangling your data, moving your data, preparing it, finding outliners in your data, right? Because what happens is if you take a road load data acquisition, the guy drives around a track 100 times, and then one time he hits the curb. He's not supposed to, right? And that causes an extra bit of data. I want to make sure that that curb is never in the input into my analytics, because it wasn't intentional. Let's say it's an outliner. So that type of work, you have to do that before you feed it in. Good data is extremely important.
So we're not throwing away. So if I look at some engineering simulation results, yeah, I'll use my engineering intuition experience, as you say, to spot the outliers, to spot the bad data points. Yeah. Sometimes I'll do that accurately. Sometimes it won't be accurate, and maybe I should have included that in the set, but that's a different point.
Yeah.
So that process, that part of the process is still manual, or can we train the algorithms to identify and spot the outliers?
You can use machine learning and algorithms as a way to sort and filter your data as well. Yeah, absolutely. So there's technologies out there to like a UMAP type of display, where you unstructured learning, you basically throw all your data into the unstructured learning, and then the output then is just scatter plots, and then from those scatter plots you'll see like islands kind of form. And you can label those islands, right? You can say, well, maybe you find something interesting about those islands, you label them. But what you'll also find is the outliners will be like, they'll be far away. They won't be near any island, let's say. And those are really good indications of data points that are not relevant for your data set. And then you take those and you basically exclude them for your input. When you're looking at the data, by the way, the data basically is you're feeding it in. You have maybe, say, 1,000 data points. You're going to take 80% of that data, use that for the training, and then the other 20% for validation. Now, if one of those outliner data points was being used for the validation, let's say, you're not going to get a good result, you know, because it's outside your norm. And that's why you want to make sure they're excluded. You also want to find out why.
Right. So it comes down to basically making sure that you're training appropriately, and then when you use it in anger, you can spot those things and exclude them if necessary, which makes sense.
Yeah.
So we've talked about the effort that's involved in data processing, which I guess will decline as we go on with this as well, because there'll be more and more tools available and things, people will have more experience doing this. But how much is this at the moment the purview of data scientists, or how much is it that is it something that regular engineers like me can access, or do you have to be a data scientist to make this useful at the moment?
So I would say there is a gap in knowledge, understanding, experience between the data scientist and the engineering, the traditional engineer that would come out of college, right? Depending on your mechanical or electrical, whatever. There is a gap Even if we took an engineer 10 years ago and we said, hey, here's a job, you're now going to be an NVH specialist, they would have zero NVH experience. It's very hard to get that in college, right? So regardless, you're going to build it up. So the types of, in any way, and we see universities today, they're transforming their programs. Pretty much every university out there is transforming their programs to say that if you are an engineer, you're going to have machine learning as a curriculum. It's going to be a topic that you're going to learn a lot about. So data science is part of the curriculum now. So the engineers coming out, they're more familiar with Python and the machine learning processes than they ever have been before. So that's changing. But myself, it took a while. I had to go and learn it, and I had to figure it out. And I still don't know everything. And I'm not a Python user. I'm still at that level of trying to understand the big picture. I have, thankfully, there's teams in here that know Python very well and can build up the models and do the work. But they themselves were, and one of them was an acoustic specialist, and he's now writing a machine learning algorithm to take all of his knowledge and all of his experience and put that into a machine learning algorithm. So basically he's saying, I want this machine learning algorithm to be an acoustic specialist that he can then, so copy him and put him all over the place. And we actually have a good use case for that.
So, and that's a good point, yeah? So you've got gnarly old guys like me and you, yeah, you know, kind of looking at the end of our careers. Yeah. We're closer to the end of our careers than we are to the start of it. You've got all these younger engineers coming through who have got this built-in machine learning, data science expertise because they're learning in college, I guess, because they're young and impressionable, they can take on the new information. I guess one of the use cases for all this is that people like us, you know, people who've worked in industry for a long while, we accumulate experience, but it's all stuck inside our heads. Engineering experience applied to projects. So what is the payoff? Let's start. We talked a lot about the obstacles to accessing this, yeah, which probably isn't fair. What is the payoff for mastering massive engineering data analytics?
The payoff? Okay. Good question. So when you look at balancing, and I don't really mean the type of balancing that I have a colleague here behind me who's got a unicycle. Maybe it is a bit like that. It's the kind of balancing where I'm trying to get the optimal energy management of the car. I'm trying to say, like, I want to know, actually, I recently bought a car, and it was an electric car. And I'm looking at it's this database called ev-database.org, and it gives you the range of all the cars. And I'm grossly focused on that, and I'm like trying to figure out, I want to get a certain range out, right? Because I know I do a drive every week back and forth and to go see my son, and I want to be able to make sure I can do that without any problem. So the range estimate is really important, and I don't trust the car companies to give me the correct range.
No, never. As you never used to trust your ICE engine car manufacturer for the miles per gallon, because those were just specialized, you know, optimized ideal circumstances estimates that you could never recreate in reality.
So, yeah, exactly. So the EV database, ev-database.org, it's a great thing. They actually give you an independent kind of study on that. So it's like, okay, well, we've tested the cars and this is what we're estimating it is the range to be. So that range estimate becomes really important. Now, I'm on the other side. I'm now an auto designer, OEM, right? I'm an automotive company. And I need to then produce a really good range on this car. But at the same time, I also want to have a really good driving experience, and I want to have a really good NVH experience. So the vibration, the sound, so road noise, extremely tiring, extremely annoying, rattles. So anyway, I want to have a really good experience. And the balancing act that you have to go through to get that, like to do energy management, like battery, power consumption, thermal management, you've got to understand the drag coefficient. There's your CFD simulation. You've got to understand the different driver profile. You've got to take an energy, estimated energy consumption. So the thermal, the fluid, the airco. It's a cold morning. I'm turning on the airco. Energy rate goes down, right? So they got to give me the estimate in cold weather. They got to give me the estimate in mild or hot weather, let's say. Battery capacity, the age of the battery, that all has a big influence in all this. And then you got an NVH guy who says, hey, I want double glazing windows, and I want the best trim ever, and I want this to be a cocoon, and I don't want to hear a thing when I'm in that car. And the vehicle dynamics people are saying, we need it lighter, lower center of gravity, a rougher suspension. So the NVH guys are going to be crying, but the dynamics people are like, yep. So now I got to balance all of these attributes. And that balancing act is not easy. So the payoff of all of this is huge when it comes to being able to get an answer really fast. I'm in a room and I have to make a decision. And I got a management saying to me, okay, what will happen if we change the trim on the door from trim A to trim B? And I need to be able to say it's going to be XYZ influence. In terms of cost and in terms of NVH performance, in terms of dynamic performance and so forth. Machine learning can give me that feedback nearly instantaneous, right? So we train all these models. That's the kind of use cases we're working with customers on. It's like we take all the NVH attributes, all the KPIs, key performance indicators, they would call them. We take all those KPIs and we take the different types of vehicle inputs, the tires, the tread type, the length, the dimension, the windows, the trim, the headliner. We take all of that input and we basically feed that into the machine learning algorithm. And the output is this person can now build up a Frankenstein car, or he has the car and the manager says to him, hey, what happens if we change the trim? And he just pulls down menu, changes the trim, and immediately gets an answer on the result. And it's super accurate. It's really good.
And so I used to work for an automotive OEM 25 years ago, yeah? And we used to have those Monday morning design meetings. You spend all weekend stressing, trying to get your simulation results working. So, and you could deliver the results from your simulations. But if you had to make those decisions, you're talking, you know, a week away, 2 weeks away. So being able to do those things in almost real time, I think, is incredible. But how about the question of trust, though? So we're making those instantaneous predictions, and you're saying that they're very accurate because they're trained using lots of previous data. But how much can we trust those? They're pre-validated, or do we have to validate those assumptions afterwards?
Well, this is the thing. So the data set that you're feeding into it, 80% is used to train, 20% is used to validate. And you then check it in the future, right? You're bringing up an important point. I can trust that data and the results, that model, for so long before it starts to give me inaccurate results. So you have to have in place an industrialized way to update those models, to feed them new data over time, right? New tests are done, or new simulations are done. I'm doing drag coefficients all the time. And so I'm doing these new simulations and I'm constantly feeding that data in, you know, say every month, all the simulations that were done on drag coefficients, I take that, I feed it into the machine learning model and I update it. So it's now got new information and it's improving itself over time. At the same time, if you completely automate it, you got to do checks. So you have to check, okay, are there outliners, right? And so there is a need for a person there to kind of like make sure that the quality of the data is still good that I'm putting into the system. If I'm using testing, I need to make sure that I have a consistency. So template-based measurement is what we're pushing there, like the automatically capturing the temperature, automatically capturing the road surface condition, all of these things, right? So automatically doing spike detection quality checks, right? So there are certain things that we do to help the process to make it the consistency clean. But you need those. Otherwise, the work in terms of preparing all of that data becomes too big.
Yeah. Right. So where does the digital twin come into all this, executable digital twin? So we talked about that you can't always measure where you want to measure. I guess that's the route into the XDT, isn't it?
That's definitely one. So the virtual sensors. So digital twin, let's say first, just to make sure, there's a lot of digital twins. There's documentation twins, there's so much. We focus, in the Simcenter organization, we're focusing on the performance-based digital twin. So that's, I want to have a digital twin of the dynamics of the car. It's the performance related or the acoustics, et cetera. And then we have an executable digital twin. And the executable digital twin is a virtual representation of a physical asset, right? I'm trying to remember the definition. So it's a virtual representation of a physical asset that it's linked to the physical asset. So when the physical asset moves, the virtual asset moves, and you link it through a sensor. And that sensor doesn't have to be the most complex, deep sensor that you cannot always measure in, right? And the advantage there is that you can actually take a use case, like we have one for CNC machines. And there the CNC machine is moving and it picks up a new drill bit. And as it starts to spin up, sometimes there's an imbalance, and that imbalance is usually caused by dirt or particles that go up into the clamper. I don't know what you call that clamper.
Neither do I.
So it goes up, and we basically detect that in real time, because the potential types of imbalance you get, you can measure it, but you can't. It's hard to measure it right at that location. So what we do is we actually measure it in a different location, and we use a digital twin to help us get the exact location we need. And we tell basically now this is kind of digital twin that's being built into the machine, so that you as an operator, it'll inform you, there's an imbalance, and the operator then will either activate the air system to blow out the clean thing, the bit, and clean it, and then it will reattach and continue its job. So that's a type of virtual sensor. I can't measure in location A, I can measure in location B, and I'm going to create a model to help me do that.
So you can't measure in the center of your molten vat of steel, which was your early example, but you can put sensors on the wall outside of the vat,
yeah,
and you can use simulation to work out what the result should be in the place where you're really interested in it. Okay.
Yeah. Now, in order to do that, though, the simulation, those type of simulations aren't simulations that you run in real time. So we have to take that simulation and reduce it down. And we have reduced order modeling technology to take that, reduce it down, so they can run in real time. And not every simulation has to run in real time. Right? That's the other thing. Some simulations can run in the cloud, and they can run, you know, periodically with new data inputs. And we have a system set up for a water company. This is a nice one. I actually like it because it manages the entire water infrastructure of a country, right? And think of the amount of pumps, think of the amount of valves, think of the amount of motor, all of these systems running. And it's extremely complex. And you want to be more efficient. You want to make sure that you can predict what is the usage going to be so I can get the water to the location it needs to be so that it's available for the people. That's the job, efficiency. And you can suffer because if you're not predicting well enough, you're pumping and you're costing more money. Night tariff, day tariff. Maybe you have solar panels out there. I saw that recently, solar panels on top of the water reservoirs. And the thing is, we'll drink to that, right? So solar panels on top of the water reservoir to collect the energy, right, when the water's there. So basically powering it during the day, so it's cheaper during the day. So if I can predict the usage when I have the energy, I can then save myself a lot of money. So machine learning to help you predict, but it's not only about the machine learning. I also have a physics model of all the different valves, of all the different pumps to help me predict when things will fail that I haven't ever measured before. Does that make sense?
Yeah. Of course.
But machine learning is great for, I have measured it and I have that data, but if I haven't measured it, if it's something that has never broken before, if it's something that has never happened before, or never failed, it's not part of my failure mode effect analysis, the FMEA, but it hasn't failed before, so I don't know it. The physics models are needed for that because they can predict when that failure will occur because it's physics based. It's saying to you, oh, this is going to fail. Your model is updating in real time with the real data feeding into it. And it'll tell you your pump is going to overload or your pump needs to cool down. And we've never seen this before because it's an unusual case, situation, you know, slash whatever. So the need for that combination, I would call it model-based machine learning, is great because now you can have that mix of machine learning, which is experience, like what we were talking about, you and I, those crusty old guys with all of our experience, combined with a physics-based model that gives you the insight into the structure as it is today, because the model updates. So the model I have today is different to the model I had a month ago. It's updated itself, and it's updating every day, right? So that combination. And then we also have ones where we have machine learning with real-time physics models linking in to the cloud where you have very complex CFD calculations running. And those complex CFD calculations are updating every 10 minutes or so. So we're feeding it with new input. It runs, it delivers the output, and then updates the overall system network, making improvements. We did that for syringes. Nice example. We did that one for syringes, that kind of use case. And we did it for food industry, extruder, for potato chips. Crisps. I call them crisps.
What do you guys call them?
I call them crisps as well. Our American friends might call them chips, though, which is the wrong thing to call them. We can agree that.
I'm glad you said that. Yeah, so those potato chips. So those type of examples are being used in a lot of different areas.
So I recently spoke to somebody at a conference who was using executable digital twins in military satellites. Yeah, and so satellites they fire them into space and they orbit, but sometimes they're disturbed by solar forces or by impacts and they have to adjust their attitude, and so they use momentum wheels which basically spin up. And create a torque which changes the angle of the satellite. Now, those, in order to measure the health of those momentum wheels, they've got a limited number of sensors, and they use executable digital twin. But they use it also for kind of cyber security as well. So if there was an attack on that satellite, a cyber attack on that satellite, they might use some of those sensors or lose some of those sensors. But using the executable digital twin, they can kind of recreate the data from the missing sensors and keep the asset operational as well, which I guess is another usage in a kind of cybersecurity aware world.
Yeah, it's cool actually. I didn't know that example was existing. I love that use case because it's not only usable for extending your sensor range out to things that you can't measure, but it's also usable in case a sensor has failed.
Yeah.
And, you know, so something has been damaged, a sensor has failed, and we need to kind of understand what the latest information. That's a nice example because you can't get up there and access it. And the really great thing is that you can take the model from a week ago before the incident and the model now, and then compare the two with each other and see, okay, what is different about this structure that we might gain some insight to that we can't gain because we can't physically look at it. You know, we can't see it, let's say. I can't touch it unless there's somebody there. But that's a really cool example.
So the digital twin is a real physical asset, yeah, operating, you know, under the circumstances it was designed for, and perhaps some extra circumstances it wasn't designed for. Yep. To what extent can we take the learning, the data accumulated by that digital twin, and use it to future generations of that product or that vehicle or whatever? Is that a use case? So can we learn from real life experience and build that into our next generation of designs?
Not only next generation, but existing. So imagine you're changing the way you sell a tractor today. You sell a tractor and you say, I'm going to sell it for its life. Here you go. You pay a paid up price. Or I could sell you based on the damage that you do to the tractor. Now there's an expected damage, right? Which is, it's got a damage curve. And if you're using the tractor like you normally should, that won't change. And I can now measure that with an executable digital twin and say, well, actually, you know what? You didn't do that much. You were doing light work. You weren't abusing the system. You were using it as intended. And you're paying less than you normally would because it's actually in good condition. So apply that not just for a tractor, and apply it for every car, every scooter, right? That's out there. You know, those e-scooters that are going around. I want to know, okay, one of them has been damaged more than it should have been. I need to go find it. So in that context of what we would call a customer correlation, you know, KUKO, there's a project that started in Germany, in Europe, 1982, around that time frame. We were working on what we call the KUKO customer correlation, which was trying to understand in different environments how people use products, right? How people use cars in that case. But it's not just for cars. You can apply it to anything. I've seen Scottish people take a French fry machine and dip a pizza in it. I was like, why? So people use products in ways you will never expect. They even did a Mars bar. Like they took a Mars bar, put it in some batter, and then threw it in the...
It's part of their cultural heritage now, I think, is a deep fried Mars bar.
Yeah. Okay. So you can always expect people to use your products in the way that you design them, and the executable digital twin, because you have that extended sensor range, let's say, allows you to get that information earlier. And the one thing I like, you were talking about security, I don't have to send the data. I can send the model. The model's secure. So I can have the data on the vehicle or on the component. And the data is basically updating the model, and it's giving me that executable model, basically, is updating. And then I send the model back over. The model's small enough. And the model then, I can then rerun that model locally in a secure way and basically get the extended data that I need. And I can compare models. I can see the difference between the model in India and the model in China. And see, okay, how are these model, how are these systems being used differently? And the reason you might do that is because you want to have a, when you want to compare something, you know, you try and take the same input loading for both. You say, okay, what is, if I use this input loading in the same in both models, what is the difference? How do they perform? Whereas the input loading in China might be different to the input loading in India or Australia or Europe, let's say.
So that's really interesting. So in terms, going back again to massive engineering data analytics,
yeah,
where are we on that journey as engineers? I guess, you know, I, like I said at the start, all of us have been, we've been big data people since before big data, yeah, was a thing. But to what extent is industry kind of tooled up at the moment to use that data?
Yeah. So
are we early on the journey, or is it already a mature approach, would you say?
Definitely not mature. No. So it's, we're still early. Let's say there are, what you now see is, like, if you look at machine learning in our daily use, you got Netflix telling you what you need to watch next, and this is a, you like this show kind of thing. I personally hate that, but you got nicer examples, like we're improving our energy usage, you know, because we're optimizing the temperature, the lighting, and we're decreasing the overall wasted energy in buildings. We're using machine learning in financing, you know, spotting odd behavior. This is a nice one where suddenly, hey, we see that you're spending something that you normally wouldn't spend. Yeah, is that really you?
My wife does that for me, but I guess algorithms could do it as well.
Well, the algorithms are sometimes they remind you. Yeah, are you really doing that?
Yeah,
yeah, yeah. I am. You know, so they, and then you get the large, they call it large language model, LLMs, like the chat GPT. You know, where you say, hey, write a poem about my son, and you give it all the conditions, and you got a poem. What they're finding about those chat GPT is they go even further than they expected. They can now help you generate executable code. So they're expanding it out even further than they thought they could originally. So the use cases are expanding. In our world of engineering, I can't rely on the same type of machine learning algorithm to help me make design decisions. It's not industrialized enough, right? It's okay if it's Netflix telling me what to watch. It's okay if the thermostat didn't turn off on time. But if I'm in, let's say, Siemens Energy, and I'm relying on this machine learning model to help me do an actionable item control loop where it's going to shut that thing off and help it cool down properly, you know, this generator, and then turn it on at the appropriate time, right, and speed it back up again. I can't rely on this the same type of algorithm. I have to have good data. Good data is key. Quality data is
key.
Yeah,
and you have to be able to trust the decisions, don't you, in those circumstances as well?
Yeah.
Because the consequences of getting them wrong are much, much higher.
And the consequences of, I quickly rely on it, happen. You know, I don't know if that makes sense. It's like I very quickly get comfortable with tool and I rely on its results, and then suddenly it's wrong and I'm still relying on it and I don't question it enough. So you have to have that question. So what we're building is this Bayesian neural network. Don't ask me more about that.
It's one of my favorite topics, but anyway, I'll let you explain. Can you quickly explain Bayesian to us?
Well,
no, you can't.
So anyway, I know what it does. It gives you the accuracy level of the prediction. And it tells you, okay, here's a predicted result, and this is the level of accuracy. This is how the level of quality that you're getting out of it. This is how much you can trust it. And I think that's what's nice about that technology, is that we have to build those types of guards, safeguards into the models that we're building. Because if I'm going to really rely on this result to make it a very costly, expensive decision, that could potentially harm somebody, I need to make sure that I'm using I have some sort of fallback to say, well, here's a prediction and this is the quality of that prediction. So when I'm making that decision, I know with a certain confidence level why. Because I can always say, I'm sorry, I can't tell you right now. I'm going to have to run a new test or a new simulation, and I'll come back to you in a week. Like you're saying, a week's time. That's what it takes. And that should be okay.
Yeah, I think what the Bayesian stuff does, it means that you need much more evidence, yeah, to convince you of things which you wouldn't normally expect. So if I show you a picture of my child and it looks like, I could show you a picture of any baby, yeah, and you'd accept it as a baby. If I show you a picture of a dog, yeah, dressed up in baby's clothes, you're going to question that and say, well, I'm going to take a lot more convincing before I accept that that's your baby. Yeah. And I mean, that's a very crude example. But that's what Bayesian inference does, as far as I understand it anyway. So that's quite, I'm just really, it's really cool that we're building that kind of technology into machine learning, because that's a question I've had for a while. So I'm glad to hear you use those words as well. So if you're involved with simulation, you're involved with test, you do validation, you're kind of a standard engineering simulation and test literate company who's using it in day-to-day business, but you wanted to get involved in massive engineering data analytics. What are the first steps, do you think, that you need to take?
First steps is you should have a good process in place, right? So on the testing world, that means that I have requirements. There's a requirements management tool that's requesting a test to come in. And I then, from then on, have a consistent approach to perform that actual measurement. Or, you know, so in other words, I have a naming convention. I know this channel, accelerometer or microphone, it has a certain name. And for that specific test that's being requested, it's the same all the time. It doesn't change. It doesn't change from microphone 1 to microphone 22. It's microphone front left, whatever, right? It's got a name because of its location, and that location is fixed. So that kind of consistency, that kind of procedure is important. Another thing that's very valuable is, well, what are you measuring? I'm talking in the measurement world, or what are you simulating? So what I'm measuring or what I'm simulating, I need to know what is that device under investigation and under test, let's say. So I have to have a descriptive view of that. Descriptive, so in other words, the bill of material becomes really important. It is this vehicle with this tire configuration, with this trim, with these leather seats, with, you know, it is that. That is what I'm testing. That is what I'm simulating. And I have that stored and it is somewhere. I can track it. So I know that link is important because this is the result I'm getting. This is what I measured. And all of that information goes into the machine learning. So I need to have that bill of materials become super important. And you need to be able to have that something that evolves. A bill of materials isn't a static thing. A bill of materials is a living, it evolves over time. It changes, you know, the parts change, etc. So I need to have that historical view. The enterprise bomb, let's say, is key for that. So having the bill of materials, knowing what you measured, right? Having that available, and then having a consistent simulation approach. I have a CAD file, I go through a mesh, I'm using this type of meshing, I'm defining these type of boundary conditions, this is my velocity boundary condition at the inlet, this is my outlet boundary condition, this is where my microphone placement is going to be for my vibroacoustic simulation, and I'm going to get a sound pressure between these frequency ranges with this level of accuracy per frequency, let's say, or per half frequency, and I'm going to be able to use that then to get the overall sound pressure at the driver's ear. In dBA or sones or whatever format it is. As long as I'm consistent, that's what's important. The KPI, the tool I use to calculate that formula for my key performance indicator, consistency.
And so to finish off with, how can Siemens help people on that journey towards massive engineering data analytics?
We're one of the few companies, I think we're the only company actually, that has the testing, that has the simulation, that has the bomb, the bill of materials, right? That enterprise bomb. So Teamcenter. So we got Teamcenter. We have MindSphere for the cloud-based calculation and processing and the collection of data on the field, let's say. So I have factory floor data. I want all of that. I want to know how this part was manufactured. And every associated data related to that, right? So I have all that. MindSphere is helping me gather all that. The field data, MindSphere help. So this data has becomes really important. Teamcenter tells me what it collected the data for this vehicle or this component or this motorcycle, right? It collected that data for that component. And then it also helps me manage all the models associated with that, because it's not just one digital twin. I got one for the CFD, I got one for acoustics, I got one for things. I got the test data validating it all, right? All of that feeding into, helping you feed into machine learning algorithms to do that kind of prediction. I think Siemens is the only company in the world that has all of those tools from design, manufacturing, and in service. There's nobody else out there. Now, I'm not saying that you have to come to us for everything. I'm an engineer, so I wouldn't do that. I don't just rely on Netflix for my movies.
No, no. But often you can't, because there are other tools that are outside of our ecosystem, outside of our product range, but in the engineering ecosystem, and you can still bring those in, yeah?
Yes, and we're open. I think that's the beautiful thing about it is there's a mandate. My management tells us you have to be agnostic. You have to be able to work with other tools. You have to be able to play nice. It's not a greenfield. Customers have other simulation and other testing tools out there. Make sure you work with them, right? And then capturing that workflow, all of that with our machine learning tool. We have machine learning tools as well to capture that workflow and feed it into the algorithms and keep that updating over time. So I'd say we are very well suited. If somebody says, hey, I want to get into this, and I'm already using this and these tools from you, Mr. Siemens, how can you help me? I think we can help you a lot.
Excellent. And I think that's a great time to finish this podcast. So all that remains is for me to thank Ian for being a wonderful guest, and thank you for listening to another edition of the Engineer Innovation Podcast. Thank you, Ian.
Thank you, Stephen.
This episode of the Engineer Innovation Podcast is powered by Simcenter. Turn product complexity into a competitive advantage with Simcenter solutions that empower your engineering teams to push the boundaries, solve the toughest problems, and bring innovations to market faster.